Our Land returns this week and is focused on the Rio Grande south of Socorro. The river is already dry, even though the mountains that supply New Mexico's largest river received close to normal snowpack over the winter. On this month's episode, correspondent Laura Paskus goes to San Antonio, New Mexico, and also talks with Thomas Archdeacon of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service about the impacts of drying on the endangered silvery minnow.
We had close to average snowpack in the mountains, but the Rio Grande still ran low this spring and has already dried south of Socorro. Are these conditions expected to last throughout the summer?
Yeah, unless the monsoons kick in kind of early, which we did see some of that last night, it's going to continue to be intermittent in the Santa Costa Reach, probably for 20 to maybe even up to 40 miles, depending on how dry it gets down there. I just talked to one of the hydrologists at Reclamation this morning, and they have supplemental water for the minnow that they're going to release at Isleta, and that'll prevent large sections of Isleta from drying probably through September. But if we don't get any rain, we'll probably see a lot more drying in Isleta. As of right now, I'd say there's probably only going to be 5 to 7 miles at Isleta, but that could expand to 20 miles if water just runs out.
The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service enforces the Endangered Species Act, and specifically you work on protecting the endangered silvery minnow. How does this river drying in the summers affect the fish's population?
It's kind of entangled with the spring runoff. So when you have these years of high spring runoff like 2017 and 2019, you end up with a lot of young of year fish. It's the fish that respond in that year. So you end up with a lot of those fish, and then when you go into a year like 2018 or 2020, the drying is starting to occur before they've even spawned. So it's you're really preventing any of these fish from successfully reproducing. And then the heat and the drying is just so extensive that you're also you're impacting the survival of the adults as well. So you end up, one of the reasons that we didn't see as many fish as you might have expected in 2019 is because the drying was so bad in 2018. Not only did you fail to really produce any new fish that year, you also killed off what was already there. So you go into 2019 with fewer fish than you might expect normally.
So when the river does dry in the spring or summer, the Fish and Wildlife Service typically heads out there. What do you usually do, and what's happening this year?
In most years, what we'll do is there's a lot more consistency with it. It begins to dry in June. And we have our staff in place, and we'll go out, and each day that there's a new section of river that dries, we'll visit every single pool that forms and try to remove as many of the silvery minnows as possible. And then we move them up or downstream to somewhere that we are pretty sure is going to have perennial flows for the rest of the year. This year is different because of the COVID-19, and we've been having to ask to get permission from our regional office, get permission from them to go out and do any sort of field work. And we had to kind of take a guess on when we thought we'd be able to get out. So we'd asked for June 8th, which is actually a week before our contract is even started for actual rescue. So we gave them a bonus week, and that's the best that we could work out just because the scheduling was so bad and having to ask for permission, and we're all going to be driving separate vehicles. So we're going to head out next Monday, and it's going to be kind of an interesting test to see how well it goes.
So what does this mean, and what do these worsening conditions as the region continues to warm and dry, what does this mean for the fish's population looking into the future, do you think?
That's a really good question. I think this is kind of a worldwide question on what these prolonged droughts are doing to fish populations. Historically, when it was in the entire Rio Grande and the Pecos, maybe this wouldn't have been as big of a deal because it probably would not have affected the entire population all at once. You may have had fish in the Pecos that were still okay, fish that were upstream of Coach D, fish that were downstream of Elephant Butte, it may have actually been okay for a year or two, and now you've kind of constricted them to one 300 kilometer section that 40 to 50% of it is highly prone to drying. So I don't think anybody really knows. I think it's going to be harder and harder to recover the species if we're seeing these kinds of swings where we're going from two of the best runoff years, you know, back to back with two of the worst runoff years in the last 20 or 30 years. It's going to be very difficult to make any forward progress when you're constantly knocking the population back every other year.
I think it's probably fair to say that the silvery minnow is a proxy for the health of the river itself. And like you mentioned, the fish used to have habitat throughout the Rio Grande and the Pecos River, and now it's within a few hundred miles, and these miles consistently seem to dry in the summers. What does it say about the Rio Grande and the choices that we've made on how we use its waters if the river can't even sustain a 2 or 3 inch long fish?
I think it just really shows how much we've changed the river over the last, even pre-settlement by Anglos, it's changed quite a bit. You know, the natives did some work, but they obviously couldn't do it on the scale that we have done with holding back sediment in Cochiti, which, you know, that Cochiti was there for flood control because we wanted to build close to the river, and we've straightened the channel. So it's almost hard to imagine what it might have looked like 400 years ago. And overcoming some of those changes is going to be really tough. You want to try to think that there's some positive in there, and there is. The fish is quite resilient and will come back from low numbers, but it's going to be a constant cycle of high and low if we don't figure out some way to have some sort of management action that's going to get rid of those really low years like 2018 and 2020.
So you've been working on this species and this stretch of the river for quite a few years now. I'm wondering, for you coming back to these challenges year after year, and frankly seeing the dry riverbed year after year, how does that affect you and the work that you're trying to do?
That's a good question. There's kind of two sides to it. There's directly what you're saying, like seeing this happen year after year and not really seeing a whole lot of forward progress is definitely frustrating. And especially since I probably see it more than just about anyone else. There's some agencies out there that are doing other work that see it as often as I do. Not really, going to these meetings, and I don't think anybody really recognizes the situation about how bad it really is and what's really going on out there. So it is frustrating and kind of depressing. But on the flip side, it's also, I got into this field because of the science aspect of it, and we've been able to develop a really good relationship with the Bureau of Reclamation and assisting them in meeting their compliance with biological opinion. And we've been able to do a lot of really interesting stuff that I think we would have only accomplished by working as a group and finding other experts to help us out. So it's on the one hand, yeah, it's very depressing to go out there and watch this happen year after year and not really see any forward progress. You look at 2019, one of the highest spring runoffs on record, and the river still dried in September. So that should tell you something right there, that if we can have one of the greatest snowpacks of the 21st century and we still dry the river in September, that something needs to change there. And on the flip side, being able to do a lot of this research has been really kind of fulfilling for my career.
Well, Thomas Archdeacon, thank you so much. And when you guys make it out there, be safe. Thank you.
Thanks, Laura.